Hi guys, it is a frosty, moonlit, chemtrail splattered night here in the end times. It was late in the evening of Thursday, November 6, 2014, but it is close enough to Friday, November 7th, 2014 for me to bring you my weekly Ecological Meltdown Roundup rant, where I get my two favorite newsletters from Center for Biological Diversity and MangaBay.com, who go around the planet looking at all the various environmental catastrophe stories to just chronicle how this planet is heading into a brick wall at 23,000 miles an hour. So while I enjoy an angry orchard apple cider, I'm going to romp around the planet, and we're going to start. I'm going to put the links to how you can get these newsletters yourself, so you don't have to hear me do this for you every week. But I'm going to dive right into it. Let's start out, as I always do, with Center for Biological Diversity's Endangered Earth newsletter. And they're asking the question, could we double our wolf population, is the first question of the day to consider. Could the United States double our wolf population? Well, the answer to that question is yes, we could. We could probably quintuple our wolf population without much problem. But if you rephrase the question, will we double our wolf population? The answer is, of course not. What kind of stupid question is that, you idiots? Did you read the goddamn election results here in Colorado and Montana, that the goddamn Republicans sweeping the Rocky Mountains? It was a good day for wolf killers yesterday. Double our wolf population. My ass. Please. Oh, Jesus. Okay, let's go from having our wolf population. Okay, it is the annual Rubber Dodo Award. All right, where each year the Center for Biological Diversity recognizes our country's biggest planet eaters of the year with this Rubber Dodo Bird Award. And it's actually a branch of the U.S. government getting recognized as the biggest wild planet eater and wildlife killer in the country would be the federal government. For any of you unaware of the fact, who is the biggest threat to the wildlife in this country would be the federal government. And this is this group I've mentioned many times called Wildlife Services, a department. It's a some little sub-department of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. Okay, quote, no other government program does more every day to annihilate America's wildlife than Wildlife Services, said Kieran Suckling. Don't you love that name? Kieran Suckling, the center's executive director. Quote, this rogue program does much of its dirty work far from the public's view, so millions of animals disappear from our landscape every year with little accountability. So for 2013, the tally includes 320 wolves. Yeah, talking about doubling our wolf population. 320 wolves, 419 black bears, 75,000 coyotes, blah, blah, blah. And it would not surprise you to learn that most of Wildlife Service's killing is done on behalf of the livestock and agriculture industries, which were celebrating this week's elections. You better believe that the livestock industry is on full party mode this week. And Wildlife Services is cranking up their aerial gunning, their traps, and their exploding cyanide caps. It was a good week for aerial gunners, wolf killers, and cyanide exploders. Okay, but we did get a little bit of a ray of sunshine on the fracking front in this week's election, as we see voters reject fracking in parts of California, Texas, and Ohio. Denton, Texas showing up. Denton, Texas, in many ways, Denton, Texas is the epicenter. It's where fracking began. For all practical purposes, the good citizens of Denton, Texas, banning fracking. Hallelujah. Let's see, in California, San Benito County and Mendocino County banning fracking. Athens, Ohio. All right. And one of these center spokespeople, as voters from San Benito to Denton, Texas showed, if regulators won't protect them from fracking pollution, local communities can and will use the ballot box to protect themselves. I was just talking to one of these tree huggers in Paonia, Colorado, and learning that it was several years ago that the local voters around here voted to ban fracking, and then the Koch brothers, one of their buddies and some judge, just said, well, sorry, this your little local ballot initiative is not worth the paper it's printed on. So we will see where that goes as the frackers bear down on Paonia, Colorado, with or without our local ballot initiative. Okay, well, I don't know if this has to do with Wildlife Services or not. No, this is U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. Now, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service is not the same guys as Wildlife Services, but you could never tell from this story. As we see, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service on Tuesday okayed a permit allowing trappers and state agents in Maine to hurt or kill federally protected Canada lynx during the trapping season as part of its state-run predator control programs. There you go. The lynx have been protected as a threatened species since 2000. I can tell how protected they are. All right, so I guess the Canada lynx, you can kiss goodbye. All right, tomorrow, November 7th, Guys, are you listen up, guys. Stand at attention. Tomorrow is National Vasectomy Day. Hallelujah. I celebrated National Vasectomy Day when I was 22 years old. It is the single best decision I ever made in my entire life. So guys, if you have been waiting to hear how you personally can help curb the growth of the human species, you need to wait no longer, as tomorrow, November 7th, is World Vasectomy Day. Yep, in about 30 minutes, you can do your part to help ensure that the human population does not hit 12 billion by century's end, crowding out wildlife and worsening the climate crisis. There you go. Hallelujah to National Vasectomy Day. All right, let's go over there and check in with the world's salamanders. You know, we hear a lot about the world's frogs, so let's look at their cousins, the salamanders. Deadly fungus could snuff out salamanders. A new study in Science documents a terrifying threat to salamanders across the globe. A lethal skin-eating fungus related to the fungus that has devastated frog populations. The fungus is sweeping through salamander populations in Europe, practically wiping out the ones in the Netherlands, for example. And imports of infected salamanders could spell disaster for our own nearly 200 U.S. native salamanders. There you go. So the center and other groups are calling for the Fish and Wildlife Service to suspend all salamander imports into the United States unless they're certifiably fungus-free. The salamander import business. I've never considered the salamander import business into the United States. Good Lord. All right. We only want to import fungus-free salamanders. All right. Anyway, their next story here about saving the planet through the center's Green Giving Guide. There you go. A resource on how to give more greenly this holiday season.
That was bullshit.
Okay, enough of that. So, since I've got my hand on my bullshit button, That probably is my segue into mangabay.com, which is my number one favorite environmental newsletter chronicling the collapse of a planet. And here we go. I'm already reaching for the bullshit button. On story number one, I have to get a drink of Angry Orchard cider and grab for my bullshit button at the same time with the lead-off story this week. A conservationist sees signs of hope for world's rainforest. There you go. After decades of sobering news, a prominent conservationist, who it named here in this little blip here, says he is finally finding reason to be optimistic about the future of tropical forest. Consumer pressure on international corporations, blah, 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 are helping to turn the tide in efforts to save forest from Brazil to Indonesia. Okay, and so what they're doing this week, last week, they dedicated their issue to the unadulterated horseshit notion of protected areas, about just surveying the entire planet, about all these goddamn green blobs all over maps. If you were some space alien landing on this planet, looking at all of these unadulterated horseshit maps, you would think that we're actually leaving a little bit of land untouched for our fellow Earthlings. And but as last week's rant showed, you know what that is. And they are continuing this survey of protected areas this week. So let's look, well, I guess this is the entire planet, asking the question, is the world moving backwards on protected areas? The obvious answer to that question is an unqualified yes. The planet certainly is moving backwards. Protected areas are undoubtedly the world's most important conservation success story. But despite this, progress on protected areas is stalling and in some cases even falling behind. According to one new sobering new paper, only 20 to 50% of the world's land and marine protected areas are meeting their goals. Yeah, 20 to 50%. So we have a 50 to 80% failure rate on protecting the every other species of Earthling we share this planet with. And my guess is closer to 80% than 50%. Okay, guys, I want to make sure you're sitting down as we see the headline, Indonesian government prioritizes companies over forest communities. Let me cogitate on this one. About the Indonesian government completely in the pocket of planet eaters, giving higher priority to corporations than forest communities. And this is actually just one example from this new report by the Rights and Resources Initiative, which analyzed 100 conflicts around the world in the mining, oil and gas, logging, and agricultural sectors to examine how and why they come about. The report focuses on several emerging economies, and who do you think is heading the list would be Brazil. And we have Colombia, Peru, Indonesia, Liberia. Okay. Oh! The Salamander story has appeared here on Manga Bay. The Salamander story making the rounds of the Collapse of the Planet newsletters this week. And so now I have a better understanding of the importing of salamanders. That would be the pet trade likely responsible for killer salamander fungus. I actually used to have pet salamanders when I was a kid. As far as I know, they didn't have any fungus. Okay, so you can kiss goodbye the salamanders. Okay, let's go back. Let's go back to Indonesia. I guarantee you I will not be picking up the bullshit button on this headline. Indonesia's new president and ministers have big plans for fish. Yes, they do. They probably have plans to fry fish, to barbecue fish, or just to eat raw fish, is my guess, is what Indonesia's new president plans for fish. So, does Indonesia's new president talking about how he is going to save the fish of Indonesia, is it just rhetorical flourish? I love that term. Is this just rhetorical flourish from the same government that prioritizes corporations over forest communities, or does it portend a new seriousness about Indonesia's maritime management? I will let you answer that question. From Indonesia to Tanzania, corruption in Tanzania facilitates the ivory trade. You think so? Corruption in sub-Saharan Africa. What a concept. I've never considered corruption in sub-Saharan Africa facilitating the ivory trade. Corruption in Tanzania is enabling large volumes of illegal elephant ivory to be smuggled out of the country. And although it wasn't reported here on Manga Bay, there were several mainstream media articles today, which we'll be reporting on probably on Monday, about these Chinese guys. I mean, these big time government officials from China going over there to East Africa, and I'm quite sure it included Tanzania in their little visit, and one of the main things they were doing on their visit to East Africa, these high-level government officials in China, was going on a buying spree. I think that was AP's term, a buying spree for ivory and probably rhino horn too. There was such an orgy of buying elephant ivory with these Chinese guys that there was actually a spike in the price of elephant ivory during their visit. But anyway, that was actually a mainstream media story. But it's all part of the corruption in Tanzania. Okay, from Tanzania to Brazil. Brazilian tribes demarcate their own goddamn territory in bid to block dams. Indigenous communities in Brazil have taken the unusual step of demarcating their own land without the approval of the Brazilian government in a bid to block two dams they say threaten their territory and traditional livelihoods. There you go. So I guess they're saying this is about a 500,000 acres of the Amazon jungle getting ready to go underwater down there as these planet eaters, you know, Dilma Rousseff selling out to the Chinese planet eaters. So these indigenous tribes who have been living there for, 100,000 years? Who knows how long they've been there? A hell of a lot longer than Dilma Rousseff in China. So they're going to say, well, you come down here with your little goddamn lines on a piece of paper. How about this line on a piece of paper, you goddamn planet eaters? Yeah, right. Let's see how much Dilma Rousseff pays attention to that. Here's a moving back over to Indonesia. We just talked about the Indonesian government prioritizing the interest of corporations over indigenous forest communities. How about this? No shit, Sherlock headline. Another mining company found operating in flagrant violation of Indonesian law. There you go. We've never heard that story before. Okay, from Indonesia, I guess either to Italy and Spain, and perched on the precipice, India's vultures threatened by EU sale of killer drugs. We've been talking about this, about these Indian vultures pretty much going extinct after they eat cattle that were poisoned by some goddamn thing. I don't know what this drug is supposed to be, diclofenac. And now I guess it has been given a green light in Italy and Spain. I'm a little unclear what they're saying here. I haven't read the whole article. So I guess you can kiss goodbye the vultures in Italy and Spain. So the European Union has watched this happen in India, and they said, oh, well, okay, we'll try it here and over here. Anyway, let's get back to these protected areas. They're looking at Kenya. They're zeroing in on Kenya. And arriving at this conclusion that 91% of Kenya's protected areas have shrunk. Anyway, they've gotten smaller in the past 100 years. There you go. That's what's going on in Kenya in the past 100 years. Is actually 91.7% of protected areas in Kenya. Yep. Okay, then I guess this is Manga Bay's nod to the story on that UN climate report that I've been talking a lot about. Man, this angry orchard making me belch. Or is it this rant? So they ask, can we stop runaway global warming? And then they answer the question with the answer, all we need is the will to change. That's all we need to stop runaway global warming is the will to change, which is the very reason that there is no chance of stopping runaway global warming. Okay, I've mentioned this one earlier this week already. Russia and China blamed for blocking Antarctic Marine Reserve. This was this huge marine reserve off the in the Ross Sea. And Russia and China teaming up saying no way in hell that we're going to leave all those fish They have plans for fish. Alright. Back to the Amazon jungle. Let's look up at a couple of these. And good God, has it already been 30 minutes? Okay, we're just gonna wrap up back in the Amazon jungle. Facing severe drought, a war effort is what is needed now at this point to save the Amazon, says scientists. All right. Severe drought in southern Brazil may be linked to deforestation and degradation of Earth's largest rainforest. Whose name I can't pronounce, but he warns that at this point, guys, reducing deforestation in the Amazon will not be enough to restore the ecological function of the Amazon rainforest. We need to mount a war effort, I guess, meaning a war effort against the planet eaters. And so right next to that story about this need for a war effort to save the Amazon, we will close with this story of looking in at protected areas in Brazil. And we see deprotection of protected areas ramps up in Brazil. Brazil has reserved about 17.6% of its land to receive protection from unauthorized exploitation of resources. However, despite significant expansions in protected areas, the formation of protected areas has stagnated in Brazil since 2009, and many have actually had their protection status completely revoked. There you go. And not too many hits on the bullshit button today. Guys, it's just the same old story. It's the same old story. And I am completely exhausted. You're all 55-year-old wage slave has been shoveling gravel in the end times, probably mined out of some trout stream, no doubt. What I've been doing all day is shoveling. I thought I recognized trout and salamander eggs stuck all over the gravel I was shoveling for $15 an hour. But I'm exhausted and I got to go to bed because it's time to head to Utah tomorrow to the Moab Folk Festival. So I hope I'll get time to post this rant before I'm out of here for 3 days. Don't know if I'll have time for my Sunday doomsday sermon or not. I'm really getting exhausted, guys. It's getting tougher and tougher to get up here and do this. And I'm doing it at goddamn midnight every night. Anyway, enough of my whining. This brings me to the close of the Friday, November 7th, 2014 edition of my Ecological Meltdown Roundup rant. For the 40 or 50 people on this planet of 7 billion who give a shit about salamander fungus. Bye, guys.